Hi, I'm Jason Cole. Welcome to Real Jeet Kune Do Concepts, JKD in Boxing. And I'm using the title to be kind of provocative and a little bit silly, but we definitely mean it. We say that JKD is an art built on some concepts. So you are aware, of course, that Bruce Lee had a lot of boxing liberally sprinkled into JKD. And what I want to do here is go over why that was the case. Because we'll notice, if we look at the evidence of Bruce Lee's life, that he of course did Wing Chun in Hong Kong. He also boxed there. And when his mentor in Hong Kong in Wing Chun was a gentleman named Wong Sheng Liang, who'd also been a boxer before he did Wing Chun. So there was no needing to convince Bruce Lee of how effective boxing was. What we're going to get into is that it's not just boxing as we understand it today, which is a lot of times flavored by the amateur boxing experience, and the way they fight today is different than the type of things that Bruce Lee was looking at and incorporated into JKD. So we're going to really investigate that, go over what those things mean and how they change what we're doing in Jeet Kune Do from what is, let's say, the MMA version of boxing, and how they're going to be approaching it. The hand game or the striking game. So that's important to understand because they're very critical distinctions. First and foremost, let's remember that Bruce Lee comes along in the 60s where Muhammad Ali is just huge. He's really much more popular in the 60s, Ali was, than anything that we can fathom today in MMA. I mean, Ali was all over the place. People in different continents knew his name. And his style, of course, was just so different than anything else that people had seen in boxing. A lot of times, a lot of people thought it was downright heresy. You just didn't see a heavyweight bouncing up his toes, having his hands down, of course, running his mouth, and doing all that stuff that Ali made so famous. And Bruce Lee incorporated some of it in his movies. But if you watch him carefully and what he used in Jeet Kune Do, it wasn't the contemporary stuff. Bruce really did not go and create something new. What he did was he looked backwards and said, "Hi, people have forgotten this stuff, which is really good. It was discarded because people are forgetful or the tyranny of the now." And what he did was he actually went back to the classics, the old bare knuckle school style that was written very heavily about by Jim Driscoll, Jack Dempsey, to name a couple. And lastly, if you need any more support of this, just look at the Tao Jeet Kune Do, and you can see so much of the heavy boxing and the old Western fencing school of thought with it. Okay, so when we're going about that, I don't mean amateur boxing and the 16-ounce gloves on, and the way that game is played today is a lot different than it would be with bare knuckles and with no rules as far as how long the setup was going to be. It's going to be a 45-minute fight or an hour and a half fight compared to three 3-minute rounds in amateur boxing. Totally different. So first and foremost, I want to talk about the stance. Before we get into the techniques, I wanted to go over the stance. If you look at the JKD stance, and I'm just going to worry about the upper body here in terms of where the hands are. Today you see boxing much more direct. You'll see the shoulders squared up and the hands more to the side. And the jab is not considered to be as dominant a tool as it used to be, and as it was especially in the old school days. Today the jab is considered by many to be a sort of a setup for the cross. And they're throwing it a little bit from the corner. The straight punch now comes really from his shoulder. It's straight from his shoulder. Bruce Lee eschewed that, and he preferred the old school method that was popularized in the late 19th century. And he really, even still, the early part of the 20th century, the boxers were still fighting much more like this. This looks kind of weird today when you see somebody doing this, but the game was so vastly different when one bare knuckle strike could cut you up, swell you up, and certainly cause enough pain to end an encounter completely. And of course, we know that Bruce Lee put the power side forward because he wanted to use the lead hand a lot more. And if you haven't read Jim Driscoll's The Straight Left and How to Cultivate It, I definitely recommend that book for everybody that's in boxing or in Jeet Kune Do. It's just a tremendous book. But that also, it goes over the necessity of having the long straight lead for self-defense and for boxing, and how scientific a tool it is. And we're going to investigate a little bit of that today. But so much of it starts with the stance and the objective of keeping that tool, as you would be if you were fencing, between you and your opponent, and using it not necessarily as just like a flipping strike, but as an actual power strike. It's the way they used to think of the jab. The jab, Dempsey called it a jolt. He didn't call it just a, you know, a jab. In fact, one of Dempsey's great quotes was that anytime you extend your hand to somebody, whether, you know, the nail them with a whatever punch, you're running a risk of getting hit with a counter shot. And your opponent is going to be a lot less alert to counter you if he's defending against bombs than if he's getting tapped and slapped. So today's jab, you don't see it too often where it's really coming out with a lot of power. This shortens the range of it when you square the shoulders up. You know, like, look at some of the great boxers in history. You'll see a great jabber or a guy with a great chin. You know, Larry Holmes was not a very well-rounded fighter, but he had a massively good jab. Again, Driscoll, of course, had a tremendous jab. And all of the fighters that had really good long-term success were able to dominate with that great setup punch. And it was a hurtful punch as well as it was a speed shot. So it was kind of both and. Today we think of it as either or. And I give you an MMA reference. If you look at George St. Pierre's jab, you know, it's very akin to the old school boxer's jab. It was long, it was nasty, it was intending to disrupt rhythm as well as disrupt their facial features. So, and it wasn't just a setup for another power shot. And, you know, that's got to be really understood to really get a grasp of JKD. Because when you're looking at Jeet Kune Do and you think, well, Jeet Kune Do in boxing, and you go into contemporary boxing today, and first of all, the groin's wide open, the shoulders are spread up, the punches are coming from the corner, that's a different animal altogether. I'm not saying that won't work. I'm just saying that's a different animal altogether. So we're going to get into some of the basic strikes, and we're going to go over the basic striking and how to go about putting those shots together, and then we're going to get into some drills with those strikes and how to start putting this stuff together. And in the second DVD, what we'll do is we'll go over training drills and making those techniques alive and how to think about the game and what strategies and tactics are essential for using boxing from the JKD perspective. Okay, now we're going to get into the actual striking. And what we're going to show you is that probably what you think you know about boxing is wrong. Because really what happens is, C.S. Lewis called it chronological snobbery. That you think, well, whoever existed 30, 40 years ago, they didn't have iPhones, they didn't have all that stuff, so they couldn't be as bright as me right now. And really what we're going to look at is the fact of the matter that they did it a specific way to get for a specific reason. And the number one injury in boxing is hands, not face, not brain, because of punching technique. If you're looking at this jab coming this way, all right, jab comes out, my palm's down. The first thing it's going to score are the front knuckles right here in my fingers, or my thumb, which is likely going to break my hand. And Mike Tyson was in a fight in Harlem one night, and a late night he got into a fight with a guy named Mitch Blood Green. And I don't know how you get a nickname like that without going into boxing, so it's sort of... So the story, but and plus it's Harlem, and they're at an all-night clothing store in Harlem. So I'm probably going to be some trouble there with a guy named Mitch Blood Green, all-night clothing store, Harlem. And they get into a fight. Mike Tyson nails him with an overhand right, and the punch comes in this way. It busts Green up. He was swollen. I saw photos of him the next day in the newspaper, and his face is pretty busted up. But Mike broke his hand, and the fight was over for all intent and purposes. Had he not had bodyguards swoop in to save him, he very well may have lost the ensuing fight. So you want to be careful that you don't use your hands and your feet in such a fashion to hurt you. And now the objective is to try to keep yourself safe, protect the person you love, you. So the punch should come straight out, and you should be intending to score with the ring finger knuckle, okay? And that's, of course, going to take care of the other knuckles. So your wrist stays straight, and the punch comes out. The punch comes out with the rear guard staying up. Jack Dempsey described it as being kind of a bladed guard hand that is ready for impact on either corner. You can move this rear hand around, of course, as you need to, depending on where the counter fire is coming from. But the jab wants to go straight. So if you look at the jab or straight lead, it's not coming in this way. It's coming straight down the middle. And there's also a bit of a shoulder and hip turn into the punch. Doesn't have to be. You can still just fire the jab out. It's just a quick flick of an arm. And that can be used. I'm not saying that you should never use that, but if you want to land a punch with some pop on it, that's the punch you're going to use. It's going to go straight at the target and straight back. And it's such a versatile weapon. It's a very fast weapon, and it has really good payload on it. So we'll watch Aaron throw it slowly a couple times in the pad, and you're going to notice a couple of things. First and foremost, when he throws it, the structure of his hip and shoulder, when he freezes here, his hip and shoulder should be facing the direction the body weight. So his knuckles are facing the direction his body weight's going. Okay? So he goes back. And now I'll throw it a little bit quicker. And he's going to fire it through the target. And he's right back in his eye guard. So he's got a pretty good punch. Now we'll let him throw two in a row. No balance disruption with really good pop on it. Again, great punch, really good cover, really good balance. That's, think about this, Bruce Lee named his art basically after one punch. Now, I know that would be an oversimplification, but he didn't name it, you know, way of the intercepting knee. Or it's just not, there's certain weapons people like to use that just are not as versatile as this weapon. And again, I'll go back to tell you this, this weapon's versatile because it doesn't disrupt your balance. You can throw it in multiple, have him throw it three times. We could be here all day and have him do it 20 times. He's not gonna lose his balance if he's trained properly. Now, a couple of mistakes. A lot of people try to reach with the jab too much, and the center of gravity can overtake their front leg. And if Aaron does that, if he fires his punch and he reaches too far for it, he's now a little bit off balance. Now, he's going to get back to that. I don't think there's anything wrong with a long, sometimes we call it a thrust jab. Think of fencing and you're stabbing your opponent. So he can actually be coming in, and he can add a little bit of footwork and shoulder movement. But he also, if you're watching him, he's keeping his body very compact. And that's a pretty good punch. Bare knuckle, I don't want to take that. Trust me, you don't see this good looking getting hit like that. My guy's laughing. At any rate, this punch is the mainstay of JKD. And I'll tell you, one of the quick drill we can do with this, I always recommend it to everybody, is that when I pop it up, I want to make sure his form is good. Once your student has the form down with all on his own, he says go, what you want to then get to what we call pop drills, basic pop drill. I pop the mid up, and he's going to go when I say go. Might notice that's kind of like fighting, you know, you don't always just get to say go. So his balance, his structure stays good. Now I can make it more challenging by moving and adding footwork and so forth, but that's the basic idea of it, okay? All right, I got to tell you, this is probably the next punch we're going to cover is a cross, or sometimes we like to call it the rear straight punch. And I have a little bit of a pet peeve with this. This is a bit of an axe to grind. Is I hear so often from people, they'll say, oh, that was a good cross. And I don't think they know what a cross is. Because you see a lot of people crossing and they're doing this, they're dipping their shoulders down. If your shoulders dip and your elbow elevates, you're now throwing an overhand. You can still get hurt by an overhand just as well as you would a cross. But there's a critical distinction between the two. Basically, when you lose your balance, your rate of fire gets much lower. So the minute I go like this and whip a punch, I'm a little bit off balance. I now have to recover my balance to do something else. So if my opponent surprises me by doing something that I wasn't expecting, it's just a fight, so it very well might happen. And I'm off balance. I now have two things to do. I have to recover my balance, and I have to deal with what he's doing. So the less I have to deal with my own trouble, the better I'm going to be in dealing with him. This is one of the big reasons why really good fighters always make things look easy, because they're not making mistakes themselves. They're just dealing with their opponent. So when you throw the cross, you're not throwing a cross like this. This is not an appropriate cross for JKD. And I'm not saying you should never throw that punch if it's open, take it. But the basic is straight down the middle. The punch is going to go straight to the middle. Now, it's not a karate punch that's going to stop and pull back. I'm going to aim a little bit through the target, and you're going to see a shortened arc, a little bit of a loop, so I'm able to hit through the target. My rear side will turn, so my knee, my toe, my knee, my hip, my shoulder are all facing the same way that punch is going. So the punch goes straight. Now I can turn the fists over, depending on what I'm swinging at. But again, you want to be very judicious and very disciplined with this, because the more you turn that fist over, the more you end up doing this. Like, that brings your face into some trouble. It gets you closer, gets your face closer to your opponent. I think you probably want to avoid that. One of the other things to think about the cross is it should be crossing over the middle, or maybe crossing over the jab. Okay? So if a guy throws a jab, you can cross over the top of it. So it should be as straight as possible. All right? Now we're going to look at Aaron. We're going to have Aaron work at this. And he's going to throw the punch, like I said, as straight as possible. And you're going to look at the cover he's got as he throws it. Okay? It's a very good, straight, long punch with a lot of pop from the shoulder and the hip. Now he's going to put a little bit more drive on it. And again, look at his balance. That's what we're looking for. I don't want to throw something and then leave myself off balance. Think of it being in a gunfight. I don't want to jump out from behind the wall, fire, and stumble further away from the wall. I'm going to get myself shot. I want to fire it back behind my cover. Same thing with a fist fight. The less time you spend out of your ready position, the better for you. And this is the other thing. A lot of people won't throw some of their big punches when they're sparring or they're fighting because they know in the back of their head they're off balance. And so if they're under some stress, they won't fire their shots. This is a punch he'll fire because he's got the balance for it, plus it's a very hurtful shot. Now, in JKD, if we have your weak side in the rear, you're giving your weaker arm a bit more chance to gain some momentum and get some body mass in it. Now, one of the ways to do this, now he'll throw a quick 1-2, okay? He'll throw a quick 1-2. The jab comes up, and the cross comes right in behind it. And he's coming right back to his line. That's one of the easiest, most effective combinations you can possibly fire. And a lot of times, because the jab moves the guy's head, and the cross can take him out of there. So lastly, before we get off the cross here, a few things we want to avoid. We want to avoid lifting the elbow out away from the body. If he lifts his elbow out away from the body, the trajectory of the punch is changing, and it's now more likely that he's going to get hit in the middle. If you're looking at the camera this way, if you see me this way, I'm exposing this whole set of my body here. Whereas the straighter I throw it, it's much more difficult to counter me down the middle than it would be this way. If the guy just jabs or he happens to fire right when I fire right, I'm going to take that shot. Here it's much more difficult to do that. So he wants to throw it as straight as possible. And the next thing he wants to do is he wants to turn as he fires. He doesn't want to leave his shoulder and his hip back. When he fires, think of a golf swing or a baseball swing. You're not going to get the ball very far. If you try to swing a baseball, you don't move the rear side of your body. And he aims through the target. And you look at his balance. Outstanding. This is classic boxing. Today, we're seeing this. As I said, I don't mean to offend anybody, but a lot of times what people think of boxing isn't real boxing anymore. The game has changed quite a bit, and it's very dangerous for us to do it with our bare fists. Remember, if he fires strikes this powerfully and his fist is in the wrong position, he's going to break his hand. Now, he'll hurt me, but he's going to break his hand. So if you've got more than one opponent, you just nail the guy this hard, break your hand, the other guy has now got a wounded bird in front of him, and you've got one less weapon to work with. So you push yourself behind the eight ball, not because the other guys were so good, but because your training hurt you. Your training pushed you in jeopardy. We need to give some careful thought to this. And we'll come back and we'll work on the hook. Okay, now we're going to get into the hook, which is, interestingly, I keep going and saying every strike we get to is a little bit messed up, and the interpretation and the understanding of it is flawed. It goes back to the premise of what boxing is supposed to do. Boxing was supposed to be a self-defense art, the manly art, you know, the sweet science, not a sport, not just trying to go out there and with 16-ounce gloves on and win in three rounds with a definitive time frame. So the game has changed quite a bit. And the hook is another case where the hook punch is a shoulder whirl powered strike. It is not a haymaker. You see a lot of people throw punches like this. This is sacrificing rule number one, which is to protect yourself. You're striking somebody to protect you. The last thing in the world you want to do is do something that puts you in more jeopardy. And you're in more jeopardy any time you get away from your ready position. So it's incumbent upon us to understand this and then train accordingly. Bruce Lee did not throw the type of hooks that boxers throw today routinely, which is much more like this, with a very short range hook with the elbow completely elevated. Part of that really leaves the Wing Chun structure way behind. It's very difficult to recover position because you are closer to your opponent. So we want to make sure that we're understanding how some of these things fit together. This is the JKD hook, which was the lead hand would literally turn, and I'm going to turn my palm toward me, and I'm going to whip my weight around to the rear leg. And what, again, I want to try to do is, since this is a hook punch, it the shoulder whirls, and I'm going to send all the weight to my rear leg, and the fist is going to whip by, hopefully making contact as the weight of my body. The timing has to be good, so the weight of my body is passing the target, not, and then the punch. What I just did was an expensive arm punch. So the hook is right there. It's a very short strike, and I'll hand there, thank you. And my rear hand has to stay up. I don't want to get in the habit of dropping that rear hand. It's an easy way to get yourself KO'd. Rear hand stays up. Here's the hook punch. It's a very short motion. It is really, really good strike. Has a counter punch against somebody with a pretty good defense because they can be throwing straight hits, and you can get that shot around the corner on them. Now, remind you, the more that elbow lifts, the more likelihood this part of your fist is going to land on a bare head. That's not going to feel good. So the punch turns, my palm's facing me, my elbow's driving with the shoulder whirl, and I'm still aiming with that ring finger knuckle, still preserving what Dempsey referred to as the power line. Rear guard stays up, and there's my punch. It's a very short motion. So I'm not, again, winding that thing up. The more you open a hook, the more you open your defense. And I'm certainly not throwing it so far that I'm off balance and my recovery is impaired. So now what we're going to do is I'm going to show you the mitt. An easy way for him to watch this again. He wants to learn to hit with maximum speed and power without losing his balance. Before we start moving people around, we want to make sure they've mastered the strike. So the way to hold this mitt is I'm going to curve it slightly because I don't want it straight here. If I have it straight to the side, he's going to have to reach around the target, which is, again, going back to one of our major principles, is that I want to try to keep something between me and him all the time. And this punch still maintains the integrity of that, where I've got a weapon in front of him. So he's going to turn it right into the line, and there's his hook. Bop! It just comes right up out of the corner. Okay, the palm is facing slightly, and it just literally hits right in that position. And you'll notice everything's going that way as he goes. And he goes right back to his iron guard. It'll throw it a little bit quicker, and it should be a nice, relaxed shoulder whip punch. Just the more relaxed it is, the better. His weight should end in his back foot as he throws it. It's a very difficult thing to get used to. But again, it's a very, very effective tool because it's so short, it comes in on a tight angle, it's pretty difficult to see. You're aiming, obviously, for the chin. You can hit the guy on the side of the head as well, but the chin is the real preferred spot. Notice Aaron keeps, it will freeze right at impact again. Aaron keeps the rear guard up. He's keeping his alignment good. And so as soon as the punch passes the target, he's already reeling it back in, so he doesn't go too far. And that's really essential. Again, if you can watch me facing the camera, is I'm not going like this. I don't want to open up, and I certainly don't want to do that. That's reaching for a target. And that's a haymaker. You know, you're windmilling your punches. You want to make sure it's compact so you can come right back with a combination. Everything should come right back to your on guard position so you can follow up and or cover if you need to. We're going to get into the uppercuts now. And the JKD uppercuts, as we've been going through this whole thing, are a little bit different than the way we normally think of an uppercut. It's not going to be the same when we're throwing it in a boxing ring with gloves on and we're both boxing and we're under those rules. It's going to be a little bit different. We're going to try not to telegraph the strikes too much. We have to keep them as short as possible. We want to think of our punches, our angled punches, hooks and uppercuts, as being simply that, angled straight punches, and try to throw them as straight as possible and get back to your ready position as expeditiously as you can. The longer time we're out of our ready position, the more danger we're in. So in this case, if the uppercut is open, the guy's coming in, I've thrown a cross and he's ducked under it, or he's reaching for me, I want to throw a short, snappy punch. I don't want to dig down. I don't want to try to sit down and drive up. Not that that would never work, but a lot of conventional boxing is they're squared up again. They're in a different structure than we're using for this. And what they do is they bring in their hand to the side and they're really putting a lot of torque in that punch. That's fine in some environments. But the danger today is everyone has seen a UFC. So many people are grappling now. If you end up doing this and you've got an opponent that's a bit larger than you, you're probably going to end up on your back and in a very precarious situation trying to fight off your back. So you can avoid that by keeping your hands in front of you always so you can use that for your defense. And the punch is harder to see. Now, instead of going for a home run with this punch, I have a few more options on the table when I throw uppercuts more quickly with better snap on them. I don't want to throw them with too much drive because, again, I throw them with too much drive and I miss, or he eats the punch and problem. Furthermore, be careful with the way we throw the punch because it's very hard not to hit this part of my fist on skull and bone, which could break my hand. So I want to throw them again snappy and try to make sure I'm getting, if I am throwing an uppercut to the face, underneath the chin or directly into the face. Not in the head, not to the side of the head. Short and snappy. It's like that. A lead uppercut, a rear uppercut, mainly a shoulder whirl powered punch. You don't drop the other hand. Make sure your eyes stay forward and you don't retract the hand to throw the punch, and you've got a pretty good versatile weapon for any time somebody leans their head into the pocket. All right, there's a few variations of this, and we're going to use the uppercut. Dempsey talks about shovel hooks, and we're going to touch base on that really quickly. We're not going to touch base on this exhaustively, but before we do that, I've got to tell you something really important. If you'll notice, at Greenville Academy Martial Arts, the instructor is going to take the beating in this video. He's rack your brain for how many times you see the instructor taking a beating from his assistants. Never. So, anyway, we're going to be looking at the uppercut from a different type of scenario. Instead of me leaning my head into the pocket, perhaps I've been able to get past his long game. Maybe he's missed me, or I've been able to rush through. I've been able to achieve an element of surprise, and I grab him. And so when I grab him, he's in this position. Now, in this position, he doesn't want to try to fight and come up with throwing uppercuts. He's going to be basically trying to do a deadlift with me hanging on top of him. It's an easy way to get tired. Watch the Foreman Ali fight, the Rumble, the rope-a-dope fight. Foreman was a dope because Ali kept pulling his head in, and Foreman kept trying to pull his head back up. And that's one of the things that really fatigued George, was having to do that kind of isometric exercise against Ali. What Aaron wants to do is he asks me, if I pull him in, he wants to come closer to me. And then what he's going to do, he's going to throw these uppercuts. Watch, he's going to throw them really short. I'm fine, seriously. We're tough here. But he's throwing them short, and he's not dragging them out away from his body. He's keeping them close, and they're saying something we used to call it scraping the paint off of your ribs. He's keeping his arms as close to his body as possible. If he starts looping his punches outward, I'm going to start hooking him, and now we're grappling. And nothing evil with grappling, but you know, and in certain cases, I want to be in control. I don't want to end up in a situation. I want to be the initiator. Action is always better than reaction. So again, if I get in close, now Aaron will let a few of these punches go. See what I'm telling you? These are great punches, especially since he doesn't have to throw them only to the belly. He can throw them to the bladder and to the groin, whatever's open, depending on how tall the guy is. In fact, in boxing, I remember George Foreman, who was speaking to Foreman earlier, he used to wear his trunks all the way up to his, you know, his chest. And say, well, no low blows. And that put the element of doubt into the guy about where that low blow was. You see a lot of referees go out and go, okay, this is low. One of the reasons for that is because boxers do not want to get hit in the bladder either. It's not just the groin, but the lower abdomen, which doesn't take punishment very well. And you know, you'll notice certain things that tough guys never do to show off. They don't poke themselves in the eye with a pen. They don't slap themselves in a testicle. And they certainly don't take a beer and then ask you to hit them in the bladder. They don't do that. It's a very sensitive area. So if a guy rushes in and hits you, those are the punches you can respond with. Now, that's a very crude inside game, but it's very effective. Okay? There's a lot of people who try to run through that area. You're jabbing at me, you're kicking at me, I'm trying to run through. They run through and they try to grab you. For me to grab Aaron and for to grapple with Aaron, I kind of need to have my hands on him. You know, that's the thing. I need to get my hands on him. That gives him an opportunity to attack the middle of my body. And so a little bit of practice with this technique. Again, he's turning his punches by using his shoulders and hips. And his arm is really along for the ride. It's not an arm-powered punch. It's a body-powered punch. And so when he puts a bit of pop in it, those are nasty punches. And they're very, very, very difficult to prepare for. And I'm breathing out, I've got this pad on me. So, you know, if you're like walking down the street later, you see a guy crumbling at you with this thing on, you'd be a little worried. But I mean, even with this on, this really hurts. So I'm telling you, you'll see this in the UFCs a lot. The guys back each other into the cages and so forth. They don't allow these punches in this area. We're using them here. I would definitely suggest you hit them below the belly button if you can. But if his arms outstretched, rib cage and anywhere in the stomach will work. Not only that though, we want to, if you'll notice Aaron's power, because he's using his body. A lot of people throw uppercuts and they shoe shine, and it's purely an arm punch. Make sure you get your body into it. It's one of the most tedious things to have to learn in JKD. Once you get good at it, it becomes very natural for you, and you're very, very dangerous if people try to breach your measure, grab a hold of you, because you're able to put a pretty good beating on them in a hurry. All right, we're on the subject of body shots, so we're gonna stay on some downstairs offensive action, and interestingly enough, counter attack. We're going to work first and foremost with, I think, one of the most underused punches in the world is the cross to the body. If you look at Bruce Lee's fighting methods books, he actually calls it one of the great punishing blows. You can finish a fight right then and there. And Aaron's in a die guard position. You've already seen the cross, and you'll notice I'm wearing the body protection, not in your face. But the cross to the body is what he's going to do is going to slow it down, And this time, the fist is rolling downward because the power line's moving down. I don't think, and there's some controversy in this about where his hand position, should he use a vertical fist or horizontal? Experiment with it, see what works for you. And I don't think that because he's sinking down, it's okay to turn that fist down. I have played with it, and I don't mind doing it vertical fist as well. But here are the critical things you have to do. One, he has to lower his center of gravity. If you throw a body punch with your head up and you just kind of punch down, your noggin is wide open for counter fire. And he needs to get down, sink to the level that he's hitting at, and throw the same punch he'd normally throw. There's a bit of a difference in how to throw a body punch. You kind of dig it a little bit more than you would a head shot. You snap a head shot more. His punch is going to have a bit more drive in it. So especially if I'm throwing a punch and I come over the top, I'm going to run right into that punch. For street defense, I think this is great because most people have no experience taking body shots. And also gives you something else, gives you defensive cover. I mean, you're moving your head, getting it out of the way, and counterattacking at the same time. So if I throw a punch, I run into that shot, it's very surprising, and if I'm not prepared for it, it's probably gonna, you know, gas me. I'm gonna probably eat it and hit the floor. So over the top, boom, there's his punch. Now what he doesn't wanna do, is he doesn't want, again, like I said, leave his head up. He doesn't wanna punch downhill at the angle. He doesn't want to turn his shoulders. And he knows a big mistake a lot of us make because we're trying to be a bit too defensive is we roll our head to the outside and throw the punch like this. And it actually takes reach away from us when we throw it. So I want to make sure when he throws the punch, he doesn't take his lead shoulder and dip it towards the floor at an angle. If he does that, you'll notice he really can't reach me with the punch with any power. He's touching me, but he doesn't hit me. And I'll probably eat that and fire over the top. He's like, oh, see, it didn't work. He wants to actually drive forward and down, and that's gonna add some drive to me. So if I do try to swing with him and he does that punch, I'm gonna get knocked backwards. It's gonna take quite a bit off of my shot. So it's critical, again, he sinks down and his shoulder turns forward only, and his shoulder's up, protecting the side of his head when he's doing it. You can also do this with the jab. I actually had a guy come in a while back, his traditional karate training, he said that anybody who uses a lead hand to the body is making a grievous mistake or grievous error. And I don't know where he got that from, but you can still land a very heavy punch. The difference here is he's going to drive downward as he drives. So when he throws the lead punch to the body, he can put a bit of step into it and stick it into the body like he's stabbing me. And it's still a really good punch, especially if I'm blocking the jab line to the head. He can kind of use that and sink that punch to the body. So that'll still work. If I fire a shot here and I open up a rib cage, a bare knuckle on a rib, he's going to break his rib. And that's just a terrible thing to do to somebody because they can't sneeze for months. So if his arm's up, you hit him anywhere in that area, he's going to have a bit of a problem. The trick is don't fire a defensive, fluttering, oh my dear, jab and lean away from the punch. He needs to drive forward when he throws the punch. So again, if I throw a punch at him and he starts moving backwards and tries to throw that, he won't have any power on it and he's just going to get overrun. But if he sinks in and comes forward with it, you'll notice the difference. It sticks the body shot. He really drives it forward and it's really going to affect my momentum. Okay, we're going to stay on some of the other punches right now. And we're going to work with, as I was saying earlier, that the JKD hook right here from the outside, which is a head hook. We're going to be really careful throwing hooks to the head. The conventional boxing, what we refer to as outside hooks, the elbow is up and behind the punch completely. Those are generally taught in boxing gyms as your hooks. As I said, the JKD hook keeps the elbow slightly down, driving up behind it, very much like a corkscrew hook. The corkscrew hook in the continuum, you have a long straight lead. You have a short hook right here, which is right in front of me. I have, again, the long straight lead here, and a corkscrew hook is right in the middle of those, maybe longer towards the jab end of it. The close range hooks are dangerous because they expose me, and I'm throwing so much weight around in short range, I want to be careful that I don't get myself off balance, leave myself open. That being said, tactically, in staying true to the JKD principles of always leaving ourselves as close to a ready position as possible, I want to throw these as body shots mainly, because bare knuckle, I start running shots out here, I'm much more likely to run into something that's going to hurt my hand. But the body punches are a lot better. So I have a foot of body for every inch of chin. And, you know, kind of as a former boxer, I much prefer hitting people in the body because there's always something to get at. in this case, especially if I move over and I throw a jab, I step in, or let's say he throws a jab at me and I catch it, there's a hook punch. I can fire that hook just like you would in boxing normally. If you notice what I did, I just turned shot right there. But I'm in a crouch, and the punch simply finds the middle of his body or finds anything that's open. I can find it from here, okay? I can step forward and jam and fire the hook to the body. I can fire several hooks to the body, then come back to the head. But again, remember, the more I raise that punch up and start seeking the head with my elbow out, the more likelihood I'm going to miss, the more likelihood I'm going to end up hitting something I don't want to hit. The body, softer, I want to avoid, obviously, his elbows. If he's got some kind of a belt buckle on, something like that, I want to avoid hitting anything hard. The good thing about America getting fatter is that it's, you know, more likely you're going to hit something fairly soft. And I do hear this objection, what if he's really fat? I don't even know how to answer. I don't know where to begin with that. It's going to hurt, okay? So nobody's going to be so fat, it's going to be you're harpooning a whale with it. You're just going to get your arm lost. You don't have to worry about it. Just hit whatever's free there. And especially when you get good footwork and maybe you're using some hand traps. You're using, let's say, as I showed you, I love using a pak sao. Or even in a case where a lot of times in Wing Chun, we get a lap sao and coming back this way. Well, I like lap sao with a short uppercut right there, and that's a pretty good shot. You're putting, with the hook punch, I'm simply, again, turning my strike and firing the hook through. And in this case, the closer I am with the shovel hooks, I can also angle it out slightly. And I'm doing this because I generally have my foot outside of his foot. I certainly don't want to try this from here to try to go around his guard. I can get away with that if Aaron is very acquiescent and maybe he's afraid of me. If Aaron decides right here to fire, you know, oh my goodness, I'm in pretty bad shape right here. And I never did that anywhere in my boxing career, you know. But I think you'll run into problems of we could become a little bit overly enthusiastic about a strike and we want to score that strike. And so this is one of those things where, you know, I remember going out there and going, I really want to land a hook to the body. No matter what I do, I want to land a hook to the body. And going out there and just running into a shot. That's one of the worst punches you're going to take because you're moving your head into the punch. You know, you're really helping him hurt you. And so you want to be careful. The hooks to the body and those short-range punches are fantastic when you have better position than him. And you can use those angles to really exploit. A lot of people have bad footwork. And so you can get around them and open shots up. If you use footwork and you don't have any good body shots, you'll have a lot of trouble scoring and exploiting the footwork mismatches you created. Okay? Think of it in basketball. If, you know, I have a three-pointer and I can post up, but I need a guy that can go in and get rebounds and take the ball to the basket. That's really what the short-range punches are doing. Those are your short-range artillery, and you're, especially as the fight goes to the inside. One of the theories in boxing to say different than, say, Wing Chun or different than MMA. In Wing Chun, if a guy gets close to me, I want to control his hands. A boxer is going to be thinking, well, I want to control his hands because if I'm controlling his hands, I have my hands on him, I'm not hitting him. I want to try to use my footwork and my head movement to open up opportunities to hit him. That makes you very dangerous because wherever you're going, you're thinking hitting. You're thinking of hitting him and inflicting pain while still being mobile. Remember, I'm not trying to do this from just out point blank range and I'm just going to jump in and try to fire because if he fires and I fire, big problem. Because you've got a bad positional mismatch. I'm trying to create an opportunity, especially if my opponent is off balance or he's been late in responding to something I've done. Specifically, he's been rumbling at me and I've been able to shoot past him a little bit and fire these punches. But if I put myself in a mindset of I can only punch him in the head and I'm throwing hooks to the head, I'm probably not going to throw body strikes very well. All right, no boxing instructional video is complete without doing something on head and upper body movement. And as always, I'm a broken record with this, but a lot of what is known about it is a little bit flawed. If you've been watching stuff today, especially in MMA circles, you see a lot of people just shelling up, and you're not seeing a lot of head movement, except for maybe Anderson Silva. He moves his head, makes people miss punches, and people talk like they've never seen it before. My old boxing trainer, old guy, was always in a bad mood, had a great way of saying, son, there's only two ways you're going to move your head. You're going to move it or your opponent will move it for you. So you gotta learn to slip and move your head. And there's a right way to do it and there's a wrong way. So what we're going to help you with is, first and foremost, is slip. The slip is simply You're keeping your head at the same level. You're not moving down or anywhere. All you're simply doing is taking your chin and moving it over to your knee line. Okay, so if I slip left, I'm moving my chin to my left knee line. If I'm slipping right, I move my chin to my right knee line, and that's it. If I move my head backwards, I'm moving it to my butt line. There's no such thing as you're going to be on your butt if you move your head back over there. You're off balance. If you move your head past the knee, you better take a quick step because you're off balance and a slight shock can hit you. One thing to notice, this is important information because people panic. We're emotional beings. And so if you're in a confrontation and you notice somebody's off balance, you can sort of punch push them. You knock them down. In real fighting, it gives you a chance to hit them with something else while they're down. Or at least it causes a great panic for them because they just think, well, this guy's just knocked me down. He's probably not cognizant enough to sit there and calmly think in the middle of mayhem, well, I was simply off balance. My chin had passed my knee line and I was just simply bumped off balance. So therefore I'm fine. He's freaking out. So you need to remember the same thing. When you slip, your head stays right inside the knees. It never goes past that area unless it's accompanied by footwork. And remember, if you move your head one place, you move it back. One of the other big mistakes is to slip and freeze. This is a good way of getting hit with the follow-up punch, okay? So you gotta make sure you slip and slip. And that's the basic. Now, if you're in a more squared up stance for whatever number of reasons, it's still the same thing. Your head still slipping to the alternate knee line, where your head should be normally right down the middle in a kind of triangular base. If you're already off balance, again, if you're off balance, you've got big problems. You have to solve your issue, and then you have to deal with your opponent. So you want to avoid that by doing a lot of practice with making sure you get used to where your balance is in movement. Next is the bob. The bob is this is a fancy duck. If this is a bob going down, I'm simply taking my chin and I'm moving downward towards the same line of my knee. So if I slipped over here, I can bob by simply sinking down a little bit. That's all I need to do. Bob, that's it. A bob and a duck are virtually identical because a duck simply, I go straight down when I duck, straight into the middle, my chin staying right between the knee line. A bob is a fancy duck, as we say in class all the time here. It's a duck that goes to the right parties, knows the right people. And so in this case, I'm simply gonna change my line and my level. Slip changes line, bob changes line and level, okay? Now, the other problem is and a lot of us have this issue when we're boxing, is we pull away from a strike and it sort of gets stuck over there. That is where you need a really critical technique called the weave. I get my head stuck over here, and the best way to go back over here is not to come right back over here because the person's probably thrown this punch and it's sitting over here. Hard to get back over there when there's a fist waiting for you. So you weave back underneath. The way to weave properly, again, I'm gonna bend at the waist and knees a little bit. My chin is going to follow that knee line. I'm going to go here, keep my chin right in the middle, and come back out. If I move my head any further than that, I'm going to really adversely affect my balance. A great practice in shadow boxing is to make sure you're moving your head before you worry about moving your feet. So if you're moving your feet too much, you can sometimes be covering up the fact that you're moving your head too far. And moving your head too far is just as bad as not moving ahead at all because it leaves you exposed for the follow-up strike. And lastly, you have to get good at timing in the head movement. One of the best practices you can possibly do, and I encourage this to everybody, is to get in front of a TV and shadow box. And you could be throwing your punches, and every time there's a scene cut, move your head. Scene cut, move your head. And it just gets you the timing you need to move your head quickly. Because slow head movement's kind of a contradiction in terms. You need to move your head as fast as the fists are coming at you. And then you need to do it under control. Lastly, last thing to say about the head movement before I bring Aaron back in, is that when you're moving your head, and you've got to keep your hands up. If you're dropping your hands when you're moving your head, you're now going to have another follow-up problem. Try to stay as close to your base as possible. Everything you're doing is simply moving your ready position around. Remember, your body is moving. When you say about a punch, the fist gets all the glory, it's just along for the ride. Head movement's a misnomer. If your head's moving without your body, something's really, really wrong. You should be moving your shoulders and your upper body. And I'm gonna bring Aaron in to show you a quick couple of drills. Okay, this is a great drill to enhance your head movement and your striking because you don't wanna just move your head and say, miss me. You need to hit the guy. So the head movement is a way to facilitate getting out of the way and giving you a better angle to punch from. It'll also give you opportunities to punch harder because of the position you put yourself in. So in this case, he's going to do a cross. We're going to cover. The cover is really a slip with a little bit of cover with his hand. So we'll slow this down. He's going to throw a cross. I'm going to, okay? And then he's going to come right back with a cross. Cross, cover, cross. Really basic thing, and he's learning how to. If you can't do this at all, if you can't get your head back to that back shoulder, it's also a dead giveaway that when you throw your cross, you're leaning forward too far. Just for the sake of argument here, for clarity, I'm sorry, is that if you're leaning forward too far, that means you should have used your footwork. Now, so you need to go back and work some basic footwork. So cross, cover, cross. And now he's going to go cross, cover, cross, hook, cross, bob and weave, bob and weave. Okay? So he's getting all of his head movement in there in this case. Just like that. Okay? So you can see him. I'm going to do it again. He goes under. He goes under. Okay? And I'll add the mitts back to it. Okay? He's minimizing that movement as much as possible. It's really effective, again, because he's able to maintain his balance and he's able to strike back. We'll go a little more speed. Okay?